Good morning, everyone. We have established a quorum. I ask all guests and visitors to please retire behind the rail. The members have taken their seat. We will start the council session today. To give our invocation this morning, the chair recognizes the Reverend John K. Jala, Executive Director of Agape African Senior Center and Associate Minister at the New Fellowship Baptist Church. He is here today as the guest of Councilwoman Janie Blackwell. I would ask all guests and visitors to please rise.
Good morning, please be seated. Please be seated. Good morning. Somebody just asked me if I'm going to sing to the CD. I said, well, if I sang here, then I mean the whole place will be in confusion. I mean, you will have to call fire service and all that, so eliminate the singing. Amen. I'm not going to sing. I'm going to pray. I'm going to lead a devotion. I thank you, Brother President, for inviting me.
Thank you.
Madam Councilwoman and my own councilman and all of you. Thank you. God be with you. Let me read Proverbs 29, verse 2. Proverbs 29, verse 2. When the righteous are in authority, the people rejoice. But when the wicked beareth rule, the people mourn. Just for this this invocation, let me take the opportunity that God gave me to appear before you to remind you that your action, whatever you do in this chamber, affects real people. Whatever you do here affects real people. And according to the passage I read, you have options. You can either do it the righteous way, God's way, the right way, or you can do it the wicked way, the ungodly way, the selfish way, the self-aggrandizing way. So, your maker is saying that the choice is yours. But you should remember that your decisions, your actions affect real people. They affect us, the residents of Philadelphia, and they affect beyond, because, you know, Philadelphia is connected to the whole world. There are residents here that have families all over the world. So, by righteous here, God is not saying perfection. God is not saying perfection. God is saying people, his children, his creation, those who will choose, is by choice, those who will choose to do the right thing, those who will do to just give justice to somebody because it's the right thing to do, regardless of who it is. That decision that comes before you here, you will just decide to do it the right way because it's the right, just because it's the right thing. Or you can do it the other way. But when you do the other way, the wicked way that God described, of course you know that you do not have your master's approval for that. You do not have God's approval for that. But when you do it God's way, the right way, the righteous way, you have God's blessing. Amen.
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 Shall we stand and pray? Our Father in heaven, I thank you for your children whom you have called to serve their people in this chamber at this time. Bless them, guide them, protect them, and give them wisdom to exercise the authority you have delegated to them in ways pleasing to you, so that when their people, residents of the city of Philadelphia, will prosper and rejoice. We pray for our city mayor and all who works with him. Imbue them with wisdom to exercise authority righteously. We pray for this great country, by your grace, the greatest country on earth, that you will continue to keep us by your power. We uplift our President Barack Obama, his family, and all who work with him. Protect and guard them. Give them the wisdom and fortitude they need to meet the challenges they face each and every day. We pray for the people of the United States, especially the people of Pennsylvania and the city of Philadelphia. Deliver us from all evil and keep us as the apple of your eyes. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you for those inspiring words. Thank you, Councilwoman. Thank you so much. The next order of business is the approval of the journal of the meeting on Thursday, March 27, 2014. The chair recognizes Councilman Greenlee.
Thank you, Mr. President. I move that the journal of the meeting of Thursday, March 27, 2014 be approved.
Second. Thank you. It has been moved and properly second that the journal of the meeting of Thursday, May 27, 2014 stand approved. All those in favor? Those opposed, ayes have it, and the journal is approved. The next order of business is request for leave of absence, and the chair recognizes Councilman Jones.
Thank you, Mr. President. On behalf of the Democrats, there are no requests for leaves of absence today.
Chair thanks the gentleman. Chair recognizes Councilman O'Neill.
Thank you, Mr. President. On behalf of the Republicans, there are no requests for leave of absence.
Chair thanks the gentleman. Before we proceed, I would like to recognize members of the Alumni Association, City Council's own, our good friend, Councilman Frank Rizzo. And where is our other good friend, Councilman Frank DeChico? I just saw him here. Well, thank you guys for always checking up on us, making sure we're doing the right thing. Thank you. Good seeing you. Good seeing you, friend. This time I would like to dispense with the regular order of business, and I would like to thank everyone who has come here today. We really appreciate the fact that you felt enough about your government that you came down to witness in person. We really truly hope that you enjoy your stay here today so much so that you come back again. So again, thank you all very much for being here. This time, the chair recognizes Councilman Greenlee, who will present a resolution on my behalf honoring Bennie Golson. With Mr. Golson and those accompanying him, please join the councilman at the podium. And joining Councilman Greenlee, we have Councilwoman Blackwell, Councilwoman Brown, and Councilwoman Tasco. And we actually have Stephanie Marsh, member of the administration.
Thank you, Mr. President. Good morning, everyone. It's great to honor a native Philadelphian who has been so internationally recognized over these many, many years. This is a resolution honoring, recognizing, and celebrating the lifetime musical achievements of Bennie Golson for his contributions to the world of music through radio, television, and film. Whereas Bennie Golson is a multi-talented and internationally recognized jazz legend, undertaking the roles of composer, arranger, lyricist, producer, as well as a tenor saxophonist of world note. And whereas being born and raised in North Philadelphia, Mr. Golson attended Benjamin Franklin High School and played with several other promising young musicians, including John Coltrane, Red Garland, Jimmy Heath, Percy Heath, Philly Joe Jones, and Red Rodney. And whereas few jazz musicians can claim to be true innovators, and even fewer can boast of a performing and recording career that literally redefines the term jazz, Mr. Golson has made major contributions to the world of jazz with such jazz standards as Killer Joe, I Remember Clifford, Along Came Betty, Stablemates, Whisper Not, Blue March, Five Spot After Dark, Are You Real, and...
Whereas from 1959 to 1962, Golson co-led the jazz tet with Art Farmer. Golson then left jazz to concentrate on studio and orchestral work for 12 years. During this time, he composed music for such television shows as Ironside, Room 222, MASH, and Mission Impossible. And whereas Mr. Golson has written music for national radio and television spots for some of the major advertising agencies in the country, for commercial advertisements for such companies as Canada Dry, Carnation, Chevrolet, Chrysler, Clorox, Dodge, Gillette, Heinz Food, Jack in the Box, McDonald's, Mattel Toys, Nissan, Pepsi-Cola, and Texaco. And whereas the Howard University Jazz Studies Program created a prestigious award in his honor called the, quote, Bennie Golson Jazz Master Award, end quote, in 1996. In 1995, Golson received the NEA Jazz Master's Award of the National Endowment for the Arts. In October 2007, Golson received the Mellon Legacy Award, presented by the Mid-Atlantic Foundation at a ceremony at Kennedy Center. And
whereas additionally, during the same month, he won the University of Pittsburgh International Academy of Jazz Outstanding Lifetime Achievement Award at the university's 37th annual jazz concert in Carnegie Music Hall. In November 2009, Mr. Golson was inducted into the International Academy of Jazz Hall of Fame during a performance at the University of Pittsburgh's annual jazz seminar and concert. And whereas for more than 60 years, Mr. Golson has enjoyed an illustrious musical career in which he has not only made scores of recordings, but has also composed and arranged music for the likes of Count Basie, Miles Davis, Sammy J. Davis Jr., Mama Cass Elliott, Ella Fitzgerald, Dizzy Gillespie, Benny Goodman, Lionel Hampton, Shirley Horn, Quincy Jones, Peggy Lee, Oscar Peterson, Lou Rawls, Mickey Rooney, and Diana Ross, just to name a few. And whereas Mr. Golson has recorded over 30 albums for many recording companies in the United States and Europe under his own name, and innumerable ones with other major artists. A prodigious writer, Mr. Golson has written well over 300 compositions, and
whereas Mr. Golson is the only living jazz artist to have written 8 standards for jazz repertoire. These jazz standards have found their way into countless recordings internationally over the years and are still recorded. And whereas Mr. Golson has absolute mastery of the jazz medium, he has not only blazed a trail in the world of jazz, but is passionate about teaching jazz to young and old alike. He has lectured at the Lincoln Center through a special series by Wynton Marsalis. He has lectured to doctoral candidates at New York University and to the faculty at National University at San Diego. And whereas honored with doctorates from William Patterson College, Wayne, New Jersey, and Berklee College of Music, Boston, Massachusetts, Dr. Bennie Golson, Benny is also working on a major college textbook and his autobiography. This humble musical giant continues to impress critics, fans, and fellow musicians with his prodigious contributions to the world of jazz. And
now, therefore, be it resolved that we hereby honor, recognize, and celebrate Bennie Golson on his contribution to the world of music through radio, television, and film, and on his continued success. And be it further resolved, an engrossed copy of this resolution be presented to Bennie Golson as evidence of sincere sentiment of this legislative body. This is a true and correct copy of the original resolution adopted by Council on the 19th of March, 2014, introduced by myself for Council President Clarke and co-sponsored by all members of City Council. Mr. Golson, it's an honor. Congratulations.
Chair recognizes Mr. Golson for remarks.
This is hard to believe. I've often wondered, in all my years of being a resident of Philadelphia, what did City Hall look like? And it took me 85 years to find out. I'm so appreciative of being here today because I had a meager beginning at 17th and Diamond, where we lived, 14 years of age. That's when I got my saxophone, and it was the summertime. And of course, I played in the living room on the front of the house, and the windows were open, and all the neighbors could hear me, and they wanted to kill me. But a friend of mine joined me in a year or so, named John Coltrane, and they wanted to kill two people. But we all became successful. We traveled all over the universe, I guess you could say, Europe, South America, Japan, played with major bands. But in all of that traveling, I never left my heart in San Francisco. It was always Philadelphia. Yeah. And although at that young age, there were so many of us here vying to get out of Philadelphia and go on the road, that is, travel from city to city, Chicago, Los Angeles, Boston, Miami, Oconomowoc, Wisconsin. I always had my mind and my heart here. And I feel that being here today is an epiphany. It's a magnum opus in my career. And I know there's a lot of people responsible for me standing here as I speak today, beginning with our president, President Darrell Clarke, and all the members of the City Council, and Betsy Riley, and Stephanie Golson, and so many others that I don't know. And if I knew, I couldn't remember the names at my age. But I feel that I'm a living anachronism. I'm an old man now, but that has meaning to it. It means that I've moved on ahead and made room for those who will follow, so that one day, you'll see some of those ones possibly standing where I am today. I am so thankful. This is momentous and memorable. I'll never forget it. Thank you so much.
And Chair recognizes Councilwoman Blackwell.
Let me take advantage of the opportunity. Our own Stephanie Marsh, one of the twins back here, is the vice principal, her husband, in the Philadelphia school system. And the other Golson is certainly a past president of the old Philadelphia Club, one of the most renowned organizations in our city. Thank you.
Thank you. Council will be at ease.
I know how I feel. Sun in the sky, you know how I feel. Reflecting on that, you know how I feel. It's a new dawn, it's a new day, it's a new life for me. Dragonfly out in the sun, you know what I mean. Don't you know? Butterflies all having fun, you know what I mean. Sleep in peace when the day is done.
Thank you so much. At this time, the chair recognizes Councilwoman Blackwell, who will present a resolution honoring Pastor Brian Jenkins. Would Mr. Jenkins and those accompanying him please join the Councilwoman at the podium? And joining the Councilwoman, we have Councilwoman Kenny.
Thank you, Mr. President. We're honored to make this presentation and note, although we work with Brian Jenkins and his wife and his organization over the years, that we're certainly proud that he is in Councilman Swillett's district, and we're proud that he is co-sponsoring this with us. Honoring resolution, honoring and recognizing Pastor Brian Jenkins, founder and executive director of Chosen 300 Ministries, Inc., for his courage, drive, and commitment to fighting homelessness and poverty in the city of Philadelphia.
Whereas Pastor Brian Jenkins was born in the Tasker Projects in South Philadelphia in 1971, and whereas Pastor Jenkins, abandoned by his father at birth, losing his mother by death at the age of five, and a product of the Department of Human Services of Philadelphia, was adopted and raised in the foster home of Teresa Jemison and the late Willie Jemison Jr. And whereas in 1991, Pastor Jenkins was united in marriage to Shondai Moore Jenkins, who later gave birth to their twin boys, David and Jonathan. And whereas in 1996, due to an encounter with a homeless man, Brian and his wife Shondai were inspired to create a meal initiative at 16th Street and Benjamin Franklin Parkway, which later led to them creating Chosen 300 Ministries, bringing people of different backgrounds together to meet the needs of the less fortunate. And
whereas under the leadership of Pastor Jenkins, Chosen 300 Ministries, Inc. has engaged 87 churches, organizations, and more than 1,700 volunteers in year-round services to the at-risk. Whereas, since its inception in 1996, Chosen 300 Ministries has distributed more than 1 million meals to the homeless of Center City, Philadelphia, West Philadelphia, and Pottstown. And whereas Chosen 300 has also developed 16 international food distribution centers in Guyana, Jamaica, India, Nigeria, South Africa, and Liberia, providing more than 300,000 pounds of food each year.
Whereas in 2003, Chosen 300 worked closely with council to form Philadelphia Mayor John Street to come up with an effective compromise to increase indoor meal programming by maintaining outdoor meal services for the homeless. Whereas Chosen 300, Spring Garden Street location has afforded them 50 religious institutions and the ability to participate in indoor meal service for the homeless and at risk, leading to more than 100,000 meals distributed each year to those in need. And whereas in 2012, Chosen 300 played an integral role in combating the ban on the outdoor serving of meals to the homeless, which resulted in the interjection against the ordinance in federal court. Whereas Chosen 300 is developing a new West Philadelphia location at Haverford and Lancaster Avenue to provide more services to the homeless, impoverished families in Philadelphia. Therefore, be it resolved
that the City Council of Philadelphia hereby honors and recognizes Pastor Brian Jenkins, founder and executive director of Chosen 300 Ministries, Inc., for his courage, drive, and commitment to fighting homelessness and poverty in the City of Philadelphia. Further resolved that an engrossed copy of this resolution be presented to the Reverend and his beautiful wife as a sincere expression of City Council's appreciation and recognition and our willingness to continue to battle with him. We're proud that this was agreed to and signed by all members of City Council.
Chair recognizes Pastor Jenkins for remarks.
Good morning.
Good morning.
First, recognizing the very fine President, Darrell Clarke, Councilwoman Janie Blackwell, and all the members of City Council, and most importantly, my beautiful wife that is standing next to me, that walks with me in ministry and walks with me in missions and helping people. I know there's a lot of folks of different faiths that are here today, but because I am who I am, I greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who died and was buried and rose again with all power in his hands. I knew I'd get an amen somewhere. You know, I was born in this city in 1971, and my mom died when I was five. My father walked out on me before I was born, and I was a product of the Department of Human Services and grew up. I was actually in an orphanage in Stenton Child Center. And grew up in foster care, and I knew that God had purpose for all of it, and it was through the sharing of someone else that I became who I am. 2 weeks ago, my foster mother went home to be with the Lord, and we celebrate her, and so I share this award with her because it was by her example of sharing with me that I share with others. I remember growing up watching her cook in the kitchen, and sending meals down to the seniors and to the sick in our community. But there's also a young lady here that inspired me, and I remember watching the news in 1993, and many of you may remember this, but there was this lady that was getting arrested, put in handcuffs for helping the homeless down in the concourse, and that's none other than Councilwoman Janie L. Blackwell. Yeah. And I remember watching the news, and I said, if I can just be like her. And truly, it has been a partnership with Councilwoman Janie Blackwell and also other members of City Council who have been a blessing to us and helping us weave through the web of the legislative process. We have been able to now serve over 100,000 meals a year to the homeless of Philadelphia, having three locations in this region. And you heard the resolution. But it hasn't gone without trial, and it has not gone without tribulation. We've been afflicted by legislation, afflicted by rules of the city, but the Lord is with us. And I know that this City Council has been behind us. We want to say thank you. There is still legislation that is out there, and although we have won the injunction, the case is still pending. So what this resolution does is send a message down to Pharaoh on the second floor to let my people go. because we cannot afflict those that are homeless, those that are downtrodden. I close with this. When this building was built between 1901 and 1908, it was the tallest occupied building in the entire world. The hat of William Penn's head, no building could go above beyond. But in 1987, they started building buildings beyond his head. And what happened is that we stopped looking at the people. We began to look at wealth. I want to challenge you, City Council, that as you make laws, as you develop legislation, that you begin to focus on the people again. Yes, development is important. Yes, wealth is important. But what's most important are the people. Jesus said it best in the 25th chapter of the book of Matthew, that I was hungry one day and did you feed me? I was naked, did you clothe me? I was in prison, did you come to see about me? And the goats on his left, he said, depart from me because you didn't take care of me. But on the sheep, he said, come the blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom from the foundation of the earth. Because I was in these circumstances and you took care of me. The interesting thing about the sheep is that they said to the Lord, when do we see you like this? And they just said, you know what, it's just the right thing to do. I'm encouraging you and challenge you to make sure that you continue to do the right thing and take care of the poor of the city. God bless you.
Council Biddy. Thank you. At this time, the chair recognizes Councilwoman Kiona Sanchez, who will present a resolution honoring Angel Luis Lozado. Would Mr. Lozado and those accompanying him please join the Councilwoman at the podium? I'm busy, right? And joining Councilwoman Sanchez is Councilman Kinney.
Good morning.
Good morning.
There are many people in the city of Philadelphia that deserve recognition. Some folks are in front of the camera. Some folks are behind the camera. This person that we're recognizing is someone who's a friend and a trailblazer. As we read the resolution, you'll learn a little bit about his activism at Temple with the Latino students and others, but he is someone that has covered us and been very patient with us many times, and so I'm going to ask you to be patient as we recognize him, as he is joined by his family and his friends. We have the president and general manager of ABC, Bernie Pragnica, and Tom Davis. I'm sorry, my apologies. They tear up my name all the time, too. So, and Tom Davis, vice president and news director of it. Julio, you want to join him? Julio, who works with me, is also someone who was part of the Temple Student Association, and Louis and him did a lot of good work in activism, so I want him to join us this morning. So thank you. A resolution recognizing and honoring Angel Luis Lozada, you notice Council President got your name right, on the occasion of his retirement from WPVI after a long and distinguished career in journalism. Whereas Angel Luis Lozada was born in New York City on September, won't say the year, to Puerto Rican parents living in the Upper West Side of Manhattan, and spent most of his childhood in the Queensbridge Public Housing Project. And whereas, after graduating from New York Public Schools, Mr. Lozada came to Philadelphia in 1969 to study at Temple University, where he became involved in efforts among the student body to increase the number of Latinos and students of color served, and served as president of the Federation of Puerto Rican Students. And whereas, Mr. Lozada entered Temple as a pre-dental student, but graduated with a Bachelor of Arts degree in journalism in 1973, and after one semester of law school that fall, he left to enter the workforce and began a freelance career as a producer, writer, and photographer, in addition to his work as a community activist. And whereas, in 1976, he began working as a production assistant at WPVI in the Public Affairs Department, and after a short departure from the station to work as director of community advocacy group Acción Puertorriqueña, he began working for Action News as a sound technician.
Whereas during his time at Action News, the Mr. Lozada adventures as a photojournalist have taken him all over the United States and the world on assignments. Mr. Lozada has covered every president since Jimmy Carter, numerous political conventions and major news items, such as the 1985 Mexico City earthquake, the 11th G7 summit in Bonn, Germany, the Oklahoma City bombing, post-Soviet Russia, the election of Nelson Mandela, Operation Desert Storm, famine in Somalia, bus bombings in Israel, and the papacy of John Paul II. And whereas over the years at WPVI, Mr. Lozada rose through the ranks to become chief photographer, a position that he has held for nearly 30 years and has been honored with several awards, including the 1988 Mid-Atlantic Emmy Award for Individual Achievement in News Photography, the 1990 Society of Professional Journalists Sigma Delta Chi Award for Best Feature, and numerous awards from the Pennsylvania Associated Press Broadcasters Association for News Photography. And whereas Mr. Lozada considers his life's crowning achievements to be his marriage of 39 years to his wife, Nilza, and their two children, Luis Paz Lozada, a major in the United States Air Force, and Laura Maria Lozada, a teacher in the School District of Philadelphia.
His wife was also a long-term teacher and leader of the bilingual program at Edison High School, and we miss her badly at Edison right now. Whereas rather than to chase politicians, he now plans to spend more time chasing his two beautiful grandchildren, Elena and Carlos, as Mr. Lozada is retiring this April. Now therefore be it resolved that the Council of the City of Philadelphia hereby recognizes and honors Angel Luis Lozada on the occasion of his retirement from WPVI after a long distinguished career in journalism. Further resolved that an engrossed copy will be given to Mr. Lozada as a sincere expression of appreciation of this body, sponsored by all members of City Council. Thank you.
Chair recognizes Mr. Lozada for remarks.
Not being much of an extemporaneous speaker, although I work in the communications field, I wrote my remarks a little bit, and I beg your indulgence.
Council President,
esteemed members of Council,
and most especially my sister, Councilwoman, my sister in the struggle, Councilwoman Quinola Sanchez, who graciously initiated and executed this wonderful recognition and resolution. I'm grateful for it, and I'm humbled by it. I can't tell you how strange it is for me to be on this side of the railing at this podium without a camera on my shoulder and not on that riser on a tripod like one of my guys, Mark Cam. If you would give it up for Mark, he's been at it a long time too. In fact, this is so weird that I have to give kudos to Mr. Decker, who I just found out today is a fellow Latino in part, and his prodigious reading and accuracy and the speed with which he reads. There have been times when I've been on that podium and I see him read the bills and resolutions, and I want to raise my hand and bid on a cow, like an auction, you know, or something. I, of course, want to acknowledge my family, my beautiful daughter, Laura, my nephew, William Fraunhofer. There's a Puerto Rican name from you. He came all the way from Long Island to be here. My friends and family, my mother-in-law, and particularly this Caribbean-looking gentleman here, whom some of you might know, Tom Payne Cronin, the retired president of District Council 47, and one of my heroes, because the man has traveled the world standing up against oppression wherever it exists, and he truly is one of my heroes. He knew how to spell apartheid before Americans knew what it was. So having said all that, and my brother-in-law, Tony, and my brother in the struggle, Julio Olmo, who is there from the very beginning, and my brother Angel, so forth. If I don't mention all these people, I have to answer to them. And since I'm not going to be seeing you much longer, I will, you know how it goes. You know, in 1969, I came to Philly, a young, brash New Yorker who thought he knew a lot more than he actually really did. And I arrived at the doors of Temple University. The plan was to get my education, get my degree, and get back to the center of the universe as I viewed New York then. And in those days, the trips back home to New York were a lot more frequent than they eventually became. Because, you know, funny thing happened on the way to the Forum, or I should say to the New York Coliseum. Philadelphia, despite its greatness and rich history as the place where our country was born, was often, at least among New Yorkers, underestimated. Thought by many to exist in the shadows of New York and of Washington, D.C., I began to take hold of that young man and slowly but surely in a sublime way began to seduce him. Then I met a girl. I fell in love with that girl. I married that girl. She gave me 2 kids and I gave her 3. But what happened was that he found himself falling in love with the landscape and, more importantly, with the human topography of Philly. It's diverse people who give you, all the time will give you a firm handshake and a hug that really makes you feel welcome. And the funny thing happened was that the center of the universe had shifted for me. Philly had become my home. And don't get me wrong, I'm always grateful that New York was the crucible that formed me, but Philly became my home. The trips, as I said, became less frequent to New York, much to my mother's chagrin, and Philly became the place where I wanted to stay. I've always been very, very, very lucky. You know, typically most people in television become professional gypsies. They go from one station to the other until they make more money or get a better position or get better, more time on air. And I was lucky from the outset. I came to WPVI, which in TV circles is a legendary station, to Action News, which is a legendary news program. And I was fortunate from the very beginning. I got to stay in one place. After a few years, as Maria pointed out in the resolution in the public affairs department, I moved to news and covered news wherever and whenever it happened. And one of those places with distinct regularity was this council. In fact, in those days, you covered council every week without fail. You covered the Board of Education without fail. It was too important not to be there each and every week. So the regular stops, as my colleagues in the media can attest, is this city council. And it's been my distinct pleasure to cover you guys. In fact, city council can be very educational, very informative, and very, very entertaining. I hearken back to the late 1970s when a young brash councilman named John Street and a seasoned veteran named Lucien Blackwell, Janie, And another seasoned veteran named Fanny Rafferty used to entertain us by giving us an exhibition of their boxing skills. And being an ex-New Yorker, I would think to myself, boy, these brothers in Philly are really for real. They wear their passion on their sleeves. And that's the takeaway for me and my career. I have always tried to conduct myself and pursue my professional career with a certain amount of passion. I think it's a key element. The other thing that we have, I think, in common, those of us in the media with council, is that, you know, you hope all the time, even though you're at the lance of being loved and reviled all the time, that you're doing something that's a greater good. And it's motivated me. And the fact that we become, those of us in the media, have the privilege of recording the first editions of history. And to me, that's really a turnout, and it has always been the thing that's driven me. And my hope, and I thank you so very much for this recognition, is that sometime in the distant future, maybe not so distant future, in some small way, sometime, some young person will see an image or a piece of video I shot way back when. We'll laugh at the funny clothes and hairdos that we wear today, or the old-fashioned cars, or the way council looked back in the day. And we'll realize that he or she is looking through a window on the past called history. Maybe he or she will even wonder about the guy who made the image, but more importantly, will be passionately inspired to record a little bit of history themselves. And I thank you all. And all I can say at this point is I'll see you on TV, if not from the front row seats back there. From here on forward. So thank you very much.
Council PD.
I must have been waiting.
Thank you so much. And last but not least, at this time, Chair recognizes Councilwoman Sanchez, who will present a resolution proclaiming the week of April 4th, 2014 as the 4th Annual Philly Tech Week. Would Brian Kirk and those accompanying him please join the Councilwoman at the podium? And joining Councilwoman Sanchez, we have Councilman David O.
It is with great pleasure that both Councilman O and I do this on behalf of our former colleague, Councilman Green, who, as all of you know, was an avid techie and someone who sponsored this resolution every single year, so we miss him, but he's doing good work, so I want to thank him for introducing us to the importance of a paperless society that we're still working towards, and the great young people who make up part of the Philly Tech Week. This resolution proclaiming the week of April 4th to April 12th as the 4th Annual Philly Tech Week, presented by AT&T and honoring the broad and vibrant Philadelphia technology community. Whereas the Philadelphia technology, innovation, and creative communities are again coming together to celebrate their importance to the region's economy, culture, and future. And whereas Philadelphia technology community, with leadership from local technology news organizations, technically Philly, has again organized a series of more than 120 scheduled events around technology and innovation in Philadelphia called Philly Tech Week, scheduled for the week of April 4th to 12th. And whereas this week includes such events as Women in Tech Summit, Development Day, Arcade at the Oval, Bootstrappers Breakfast, Switch Philly, Entrepreneur Expo, the Philly Robotics Expo, Student Startup Summit 2.0, the Chevrolet Innovation Tour, the Future of Digital Marketing, Commit Service Pledge, North Third Barbecue, we're all going to that one, and the signature event presented by AT&T. And whereas Philly Tech Week this year will be kicked off with the first ever game of Tetris played in LED lights over more than 100,000 square feet of the Sierra Center building, thanks to the engineering of Drexel University students and,
whereas the organizing groups include Benjamin's Desk, Tech Girls, 900 AM Word, William Way Community Center, Wilco Electronic Systems, PACT, Philly Startup Leaders, Hive 76, KeySpot, Hactory, Girl Development Philly, Envigor, Aldea, NextFab, Jarvis Innovations, Indy Hall, Little Giant Media, Dream Adventures, Urban Apps and Maps Studios, and Venture Forth. And whereas the participating institutions include the University of Pennsylvania, Greater Philadelphia Chamber of Commerce, Economy League of Philadelphia, City of Philadelphia Commerce Department, the Wharton School of Business, Drexel University, and the University of the Arts, the Free Library of Philadelphia, and Knight Foundation. And whereas the sponsoring businesses include AT&T, Comcast, Chariot Solutions, University Science Center, A. Weber, Silicon Valley Bank, Morgan Lewis, Independence Blue Cross, 50 on Red, Trellis Marketing and Technology, Think Brownstone, Chevrolet, Captech, and Brandywine Realty Trust, and now for it, and therefore be it.
It's amazing what young people can do. Resolved by the Council of the City of Philadelphia that it declares the week of April 4th to the 12th as the 4th Annual Philly Tech Week, presented by AT&T, encourages all Philadelphians to participate in the series of scheduled events, the conversations, and the action around technology and innovation, and commends the broad and vibrant Philadelphia technology community for creating jobs, increasing community, and remaining committed to the betterment of the city. Further resolved that a copy will be given to the Philly representatives of the Philly Tech Week as evidence of our sincere sentiments and sponsored by all members of City Council.
The chair recognizes Mr. Kirk for remarks.
Fortunately, my dear colleague Brian Kirk due to a family sickness, couldn't be here. My name is Christopher Wink. I'm one of the fellow co-founder of Technically Philly, a technology news site, and with my colleagues, Karen Warnsice, Juliana Reyes, Peter Erickson, and Joe Divis of AT&T, the organizers of Philly Tech Week for the 300 organizations. Three quick notations. Thank you, Councilman O and Councilwoman Sanchez. One, if you guys could please pass legislation making tomorrow not rain, I'd appreciate that. Arcade at the Oval, Sears Center Tetris will probably be rained out and pushed to the weekend, but it will add over the weekend something to the technology conversation we so often say, right? Whenever we talk about Philadelphia being innovative, we still talk about creating a computer, which is amazing, it was 60 years ago. We talk about starting the country, which is amazing, but it was 207 years ago. And I think we should talk about having the world's largest video game. So anyone from council who wants to come play, we'll get you a t-shirt. We game on skyscrapers for Philadelphia. I'd love for you to play. I also want to add, 3 p.m. today, we're having a city council hearing with technology business leaders, someone with one employee, someone with 15 employees, someone with 75 employees, someone with 150 employees, and an investor talking about how the city of Philadelphia continues to become a bedrock of what the economy of Philadelphia can be. And then lastly, to give you a representative taste of the meaning that can come out of this week, we're launching, as Councilwoman Sanchez said, the Commit Pledge, asking technologists to pledge digital service over the next year with organizations that want to have impact through technology. So we're trying to connect the technology class with all corners of Philadelphia, from neighborhoods in Germantown and Northeast through to Center City Corridor, South Philly and the like. So thank you so much for the interest and support, 3 p.m. at City Council, the City Council hearing, and we look forward to coming out and play video games on skyscrapers. Thanks, guys.
Also be at ease. Thank you. Before we move on to communications, the chair recognizes Councilman Greenlee.
Mr. President, unfortunately, I have to leave council on personal.
Excuse me, oh, can we have a quiet, please?
On a serious personal matter, I would like to leave my vote as aye on all bills and resolutions, please.
Thank you, Councilman Lee. Shall be granted. Thank you. The next order of business is communications. The chair requests that the Sergeant of Arms delivers the messages from the mayor to the chief clerk. Mr. Decker, please read those messages.
To the President and members of the Council of the City of Philadelphia, pursuant to sections 4604 and 2307 of the Home Rule Charter, I am today transmitting to the Council the recommendation of the City Planning Commission on the following bills. Bill numbers 130411, 140016, 140097, 140098, 140102, 140133, and 140149. And I am pleased to advise you that on March 31, 2014, I signed all the bills that were passed by Council at a session on March 20, 2014. And I am transmitting for the consideration of your honorable body a resolution approving the redevelopment contract of the Philadelphia Redevelopment Authority for the redevelopment and urban renewal portion of the Point Breeze urban renewal area identified by house number and street address as 1721 Tasker Street. And also a resolution approving the redevelopment contract of the Philadelphia Redevelopment Authority for the redevelopment and urban renewal of a portion of the Point Breeze urban renewal area identified by house numbers and street addresses as 2325 through 35 Cross Street and 2330 through 36 Greenwich Street. And a resolution approving the redevelopment contract of the Philadelphia Redevelopment Authority for the redevelopment and urban renewal of a portion of the North Philadelphia redevelopment area identified by house number and street address as 2554 North 30th Street. And a resolution approving the redevelopment contract of the Philadelphia Redevelopment Authority for the redevelopment and urban renewal of the portion of the Model Cities urban renewal area identified by house number and street address as 3126 Page Street. And a resolution approving the redevelopment contract of the Philadelphia Redevelopment Authority for the redevelopment and urban renewal of a portion of the American Street Industrial Corridor urban renewal area identified by house number and street address as 1702 North 3rd Street. And an ordinance amending Bill Number 130946, approved March 12, 2014, entitled, an ordinance authorizing the Commissioner of Public Property on behalf of the City of Philadelphia to purchase from the Philadelphia Authority for Industrial Development a certain tract of land together with the improvements thereon situate in the area bounded by 46th Street, Market Street, Haverford Avenue, and 48th Street, known as 4601 Market Street, to include an economic opportunity plan. And an ordinance authorizing the revision of lines and grades on a portion of City Plan Number 271 by striking from the City Plan and vacating Hope Street from Laurel Street to Pollard Street and reserving and placing on the City Plan a right-of-way for sewer and drainage purposes within the lines of Hope Street being stricken and authorizing acceptance of the grant to the City of said right-of-way, all under certain terms and conditions.
Thank you. Mr. Decker, do you have any additional messages?
I have none, Mr. President.
Thank you very much. The next order of business is the introduction of bills and resolutions, and the chair recognizes Councilman Kinney.
Thank you, Mr. President. No bills or resolutions today.
Thank you, Councilman. Chair recognizes Councilwoman Blackwell.
Thank you, Mr. President. Today I introduce two bills, one on your behalf, and three resolutions, one co-sponsored by Majority Leader Curtis Jones and one co-sponsored by Councilwomen Blondell Reynolds Brown, Cindy Bass, and Marion Tasker.
Thank you, Councilwoman.
Thank you.
An ordinance amending Chapter 21-1600 of the Philadelphia Code entitled Housing Trust Fund to provide annual operating support for affordable rental units that are developed using the 4% federal low-income housing tax credit.
That bill will be referred to the appropriate committee.
And an ordinance amending Bill Number 130946, approved March 12, 2014, entitled an ordinance authorizing the Commissioner of Public Property to purchase from the Philadelphia Authority for Industrial Development a certain tract of land together with the improvements thereon, situated in the area bounded by 46th Street, Market Street, Haverford Avenue, and 48th Street, known as 4601 Market Street, to include an economic opportunity plan.
That bill will be referred to committee.
And a privilege resolution honoring and recognizing the Honorable President Matthew Shurer, PhD, for his trailblazing efforts in the fields of higher education and osteopathic medicine and his leadership at Philadelphia College of Osteopathic Medicine on this occasion of his retirement.
That resolution will be on today's final passage calendar.
And a privilege resolution proclaiming the month of April as Financial Literacy Awareness Month in the City of Philadelphia.
And that resolution will also be on today's final passage calendar.
And a non-privileged resolution calling on the City Council of the City of Philadelphia to declare the need for all peoples of the United States of America to have equal access to opportunities and accept the responsibility to attempt to rectify the unequal obstacles that exist for various populations across this great nation.
That resolution will be on next week's final passage calendar. And the chair recognizes Councilman Heenan.
Thank you, Council President. On your behalf, I am introducing three non-privileged resolutions.
Thank you, Councilman.
A non-privileged resolution approving the redevelopment contract of the Philadelphia Redevelopment Authority for the redevelopment and urban renewal portion of the Model Cities urban renewal area identified by house number and street address as 1233 Germantown Avenue.
That resolution will be on next week's final passage calendar.
And a non-privileged resolution approving the redevelopment contract of the Philadelphia Redevelopment Authority for the redevelopment and urban renewal portion of the North Philadelphia redevelopment area identified by house number and street address as 2554 North 30th Street.
That resolution will also be on next week's final passage calendar.
and a non-privileged resolution approving the redevelopment contract of the Philadelphia Redevelopment Authority for the redevelopment and urban renewal portion of the Model Cities urban renewal area identified by house number and street address as 3126 Page Street.
And that resolution will be on next week's final passage calendar. And Chair recognizes Councilwoman Tasco.
Mr. President, I offer one privileged resolution.
Oh, Councilman.
Excuse me. Point of order, I have one.
Okay.
Bill to introduce. Sure. I offer one bill today.
For yourself. Thank you. For yourself, Councilman?
For myself. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, Councilman.
An ordinance establishing a one-way regulation on Grebe Street from Walker Street to Erdrick Street westbound.
That bill will be referred to committee. And the chair again recognizes Councilwoman Tasco.
I offer one privileged resolution, Mr. President.
Thank you, Councilwoman.
A privileged resolution congratulating Marlene Trice on receiving the Pennsylvania AARP Andrus Award for Community Service.
And that resolution will be on this week's final passage calendar. And the chair recognizes Councilman Johnson.
Council President, I have one bill, two non-privileged resolutions, and one privileged resolution.
Thank you, Councilman.
You're welcome.
An ordinance to amend the Philadelphia zoning maps by changing the zoning designations of certain areas of land located within an area bounded by Lindbergh Boulevard, Suffolk Avenue, and Lionel Avenue.
The bill will be referred to committee.
And a privilege resolution recognizing and commending Reverend Dr. Aline E. Weller and Mr. Tariq Karim L. Shabazz, Esquire, for their extraordinary performance in Jeff Stetson's production, The Meeting.
And that resolution will be on this week's final passage calendar.
And a non-privileged resolution approving the redevelopment contract of the Philadelphia Redevelopment Authority for the redevelopment and urban renewal of a portion of the Point Breeze urban renewal area identified by house numbers and street addresses is 2325 through 35 Cross Street and 2330 through 36 Greenwich Street.
Next week's final passage calendar.
And a non-privileged resolution approving the redevelopment contract of the Philadelphia Redevelopment Authority for the redevelopment and urban renewal of a portion of the Point Breeze urban renewal area identified by house number and street address is 1721 Tasker Street.
And we'll also be on next week's final passage calendar. And the chair recognizes Councilman O'Brien.
Thank you, Mr. President. I have two privileged resolutions today.
Thank you, Councilman.
A privilege resolution recognizing Deaf History Month in Philadelphia by honoring the valuable societal contributions by hearing impaired and deaf community.
And that resolution will be on this week's final passage calendar.
And a privileged resolution recognizing April 2014 as Autism Awareness Month in honor of individuals living with autism, their families, and those working to improve the quality of life for the entire autism community.
That resolution will also be on this week's final passage calendar. And the chair recognizes Councilman Good.
Thank you, Mr. President. I offer no bills or resolutions today.
Thank you, Councilman. Chair recognizes Councilwoman Reynolds-Brown.
Good morning, Mr. President. No bills or resolutions this morning.
Thank you, Councilwoman. Chair recognizes Councilman Jones.
Thank you, Mr. President. One bill.
Thank you, Councilman.
An ordinance authorizing the City of Philadelphia Department of Public Property to construct on and maintain an accessible ramp and step encroachment located at 1300 North 61st Street.
That bill will be referred to committee. And the chair recognizes Councilman Squilla. Sorry, O'Neill.
Thank you, Mr. President. I have no bills or resolutions.
Thank you, Councilman. Chair now recognizes Councilman Squilla.
Thank you, Mr. President. I offer two bills and one non-privileged one privilege resolution.
Thank you, Councilman.
Thank you.
An ordinance authorizing the revision of lines and grades on a portion of City Plan Number 271 by striking from the City Plan and vacating Hope Street from Laurel Street to Pollard Street.
That bill will be referred to committee.
And an ordinance legalizing an existing hot air duct encroaching on the public right-of-way at 522 Washington Avenue.
Bill will be referred to committee.
And a privilege resolution honoring the Newman Goretti High School girls varsity basketball team for winning the Philadelphia Catholic League Championship, the PIAA District 12 AA City Championship, and reaching the PIAA AA State Championship game while finishing the season with an overall record of 29-1.
That resolution will be on today's final passage calendar. And the chair recognizes Councilwoman Bass.
Thank you, Mr. President. I have one bill.
Thank you, Councilwoman.
An ordinance establishing a one-way regulation on West Logan Street from Germantown Avenue to Green Street.
That bill will be referred to committee, and the chair recognizes Councilman O.
Thank you, Mr. President. I offer one bill, one non-privileged resolution, and I'd request, Mr. President, the opportunity to speak on the bill and resolution after they are introduced.
Thank you, Councilman.
An ordinance providing for the submission to the qualified electors of the City of Philadelphia the proposal set forth in a resolution approved by City Council proposing an amendment to the Philadelphia Home Rule Charter so that there shall be imposed upon the City of Philadelphia's pension and retirement systems financial discipline by amending Section 3803 of Article 3, Executive and Administrative Branch Organization, Chapter 8, Independent Boards and Commissions, to rebalance the membership of the Board of Pensions and Retirement by adding independent experts.
And that resolution will be referred to committee.
And a non-privileged resolution proposing an amendment to the Philadelphia Home Rule Charter so that there shall be imposed upon the City of Philadelphia's pension and retirement systems financial discipline by amending Section 3803 of Article 3, Executive and Administrative Branch Organization, Chapter 8, Independent Boards and Commissions, to rebalance the membership of the Board of Pensions and Retirement by adding independent experts.
And that will also be referred to committee. Councilman O.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. This council is a new body. I oftentimes remind people when I hear criticism that just like any team or collection of people that changes, we're a new body that has come into existence 2 years ago. And I want to thank my colleagues for their hard work and many discussions about the critical issues facing our city, and particularly your leadership, Mr. President, that has led that way. One of them that I think the voters and citizens of our city are most concerned about is our current pension crisis. And I'd refer to a study done by the Pew Foundation in 2013 that cited that 61 cities in America face a $217 billion gap. And of the 61 cities, the bottom nine performing systems, pension systems, included Philadelphia. And 10 years ago, the pension took 7% of our operating budget, but today, or in 2013, it took 17% of our operating budget, which means less money for all the programs that we need, including supporting education and persons in poverty. This is a big challenge for us. With $4.86 billion deficit of retirement money, which is the money that we owe a fiduciary responsibility to the workers and employees of this city to have their money for them, we are in a very difficult situation. And based on recent testimony, I think that part of the problem is the configuration of our pension system. Therefore, I'm offering into this discussion for our council body and consideration of all council members the following four reforms in this amendment. And the first is to add four professional members to the Board of Pension and Retirement based on qualifications by education and expertise. Currently, the appointments are primarily done by position held. And so I am including in this bill that an expert be added in the area of pension law, finance, accounting, and actuarial science to help govern the board and to help it to remain independent and to ensure that it is acting in its fiduciary responsibility for the employees of our city on behalf of our taxpayers and citizens. Second is the promotion of transparency by requiring that the board minutes, financial reports, performance measurements, and other things are posted on the website of the city pension and retirement systems. That in portion has started, but it's not enacted into law. And currently, the minutes of the Investment Committee and Benefits Committee are posted, but not the minutes of the Pension Board itself. Third, a requirement that the city contribution for each of the pension and retirement systems of the city be no less than the annual required contribution, or ARC, as defined by the Governmental Accounting Standards Board, or GSAB, which is an industry standard. And finally, the imposition of a cap on the annual assumed investment rate of return based on the average of previous available average 10 years for the market yields published by the United States Federal Reserve in a 5-year constant maturity treasury rate series, and the annualized total rate of return on the Standard & Poor's 500 index, one being the conservative U.S. Treasuries, but balanced by the fact that a more aggressive growth-oriented S&P 500 would average out that. With those reforms, Council President, I believe that we will be able to address what is a very, very tough issue, and that is dealing with our pension deficit. And because it is such a tough issue, I think it is so important that we do this, because the easier answer is to not address this problem. And in the last 10 years, we've gone from paying approximately $200 million per year towards a pension to now $600 million. So I appreciate the opportunity to speak, and I thank my colleagues and yourself, Council President, for all your leadership. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilman. Chair recognizes Councilwoman Sanchez.
Thank you, Council President. I have one non-privileged resolution, one privileged resolution, and a bill that I also would like to speak to as it's introduced, co-sponsored by my council colleagues, Kenyatta Johnson and Councilman Jones.
An ordinance amending Title 19 of the Philadelphia Code entitled Finance, Taxes, and Collections by expanding access to property tax relief programs for owner-occupants, all under certain terms and conditions.
Thank you. That bill will be referred to committee.
And a non-privileged resolution approving the redevelopment contract of the Philadelphia Redevelopment Authority for the redevelopment and urban renewal of a portion of the American Street Industrial Corridor urban renewal area identified by house number and street address as 1702 North 3rd Street.
Thank you, and that will be referred to committee. That resolution will be placed on next week's final passage calendar.
And a privilege resolution recognizing and honoring the Philadelphia Children's Alliance for their commitment to promoting healing and justice for victims of child sexual abuse in Philadelphia and declaring April 2014 to be Child Abuse Awareness and Prevention Month in the City of Philadelphia.
And that resolution will be on this week's final passage calendar. Thank you very much. That concludes the introduction of, did you want to speak?
I wanted to speak on the bill.
I'm sorry.
May I?
Councilwoman Sanchez.
Yes. Thank you, Council President. Today I introduce the bill that is part of my continuing work to keep people in their homes. I want to recognize the administration and all my council colleagues who, for all their efforts as we tried in a very quick amount of time to enroll all of the residents and homeowners in the various relief programs as part of our AVI reform measures. However, this week when we reviewed the data in many parts of the city, including in poor working class neighborhoods, such as my 19133, we saw an enrollment of less than 50% in some of these important relief programs. What have we learned? That these major reform efforts and all of our efforts were still not enough, particularly in language minority communities. This bill will allow the administration to determine and review their denials and hardship cases and enroll homeowners who may have been disqualified for many of these vital programs and allow them to enroll them in their respective qualifying program. I have remained steadfast in my efforts to develop and grow and collect more city revenues and to protect and preserve Philadelphia's high home ownership rate, particularly among the working poor. We have a responsibility to protect the most vulnerable constituencies in the city of Philadelphia, particularly our seniors and working poor, so that they can remain in their homes in every part of the city. Until last week, I didn't realize the value of an asset of a house, both emotionally and mentally, and what it means to a family to be able to stay in their home. This bill seeks to give struggling families a peace of mind and an opportunity to afford to stay in their homes. I look forward to working with you, Council President, as we have on all of these issues related to ABI and the rest of my colleagues as we try to protect homeowners, particularly in poor communities. Thank you.
So much. That concludes the introduction of bills and resolutions, and the next order of business is reports from committee. And the chair recognizes, who has the committee report for Council McKinney? Chair recognizes Council McKinney.
Thank you, Mr. Reporter. President. The Council Committee on Rules reports four bills with favorable recommendations.
Thank you, Councilman. Mr. Decker, please read the report.
To the President and members of the Council of the City of Philadelphia, the Committee on Rules, which is referred Bill Number 130411, entitled an ordinance amending Title 14 of the Philadelphia Code entitled Zoning and Planning by revising parking requirements for the Main Street, Manayunk, and Venice Island Neighborhood Conservation Overlay District and requiring the submission of a parking plan to the registered community organization in certain circumstances. And Bill Number 130768, entitled an ordinance amending Title 14 of the Philadelphia Code entitled Zoning and Planning, by revising certain provisions relating to definitions of certain industrial use categories and regulations. And Bill Number 130955, entitled an ordinance continuing the Chestnut Hill Business Improvement District in the area that generally includes both sides of Germantown Avenue from 7640 to 8705, certain blocks of streets that intersect that portion of Germantown Avenue, and both sides of Bethlehem Pike from 10 to 105. Approving an extension to the boundaries of the district and continuing Chestnut Hill Business Improvement District, a Pennsylvania nonprofit corporation, as the Neighborhood Improvement District Management Association for the district. And Bill Number 140053, entitled an ordinance to amend the Philadelphia zoning maps by changing the zoning designations of certain areas of land located within an area bounded by Springfield Avenue, Extended, 58th Street, Lindbergh Boulevard, 60th Street, Elmwood Avenue, 77th Street, Extended, and Cobbs Creek. Respectfully reports it has considered and amended the same and returns the attached bills to council with a favorable recommendation.
Thank you, Mr. Decker. And the chair again recognizes Council McKinney.
Thank you, Mr. President. I move the rules of council be suspended so it's first reading this day of bills number 130411, 768, and bill number 140053.
Thank you. It's been moved and properly seconded that the rules of council be suspended so as to permit first reading this day of bills number 130411, 130768, 140053. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, ayes have it. And those bills will be placed on our first reading calendar for today. Bill number 130955 will be placed on our first reading calendar at our next session of council. The next order of business is the consideration of a calendar. I note that the bills just reported from committee have been deemed to have had a first reading and will be placed on our second reading calendar at our next session of council. As there are no additional bills on the first reading calendar, the chair recognizes Councilman Jones for the purpose of calling up bills and resolutions on the final passage calendar.
Thank you, Mr. President. The following resolutions and bills are being called up for second reading and final passage calendar today. Numbers 140214, 140240, 140241, 140243, 130699AA, 130587, 140072, 140073, 140099, all other resolutions and bills are being held.
Thank you, Councilman. Before considering these bills and resolutions, we will have our public comment session. It will go as follows. Public comment, if you're interested in testifying on a bill or resolution that is on the final passage calendar, I want to emphasize that, the final passage calendar, I'd ask that you please sign up the table to my left if you have not already done so. When your name is called, we'd ask you to please come up to the podium. There's a device on the podium. There is a light on that device. When the light turns green, it is your time to speak. When it turns yellow, you have 30 seconds to conclude your remarks. And when it turns red, we ask that you please respect the timeline, which is 3 minutes, to conclude your remarks. Mr. Decker, would you please call the name of the first individual who is interested in testifying today?
Mustafa Majid. Commenting on 140001A.
Yes, President.
How are you, sir?
Darrell Clarke, how are you?
I'm blessed.
I'm here because I called you yesterday morning on a situation that I knew needed to be addressed. I would have hoped that you would have called me back, but since it's not like that.
Are you speaking about this phone call?
Are you speaking about a particular bill? No. My complaint is that I am representing the Honorable
Sir, hold on. The purpose of the public comment is to speak on a particular bill. So are you going to speak
on
the bill?
What I'm asking you, I'm trying to get you to reschedule the hearing on the budget.
Sir, I say again, purpose of the public comment session is to speak on a bill or resolution on the final session of council.
Even if it's concerning one of the commissioners that work here and have been violated, disrespected?
Sir, you're disrespecting the process. If you want to speak on a bill or resolution in public comment, it must be a bill that's on the final passage calendar. If you want to speak to me about another matter, we can do so after the council session. Today. No, that's all right. That's all right. No. All right. I'm just saying, sir, if you want to speak to me about a matter, a non-phone call, we can do this directly after this. Okay? Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir, for respecting the process.
Marvin Robinson, commenting on 120232.
Yes, good afternoon, President.
Good afternoon.
I just want to comment on this revolution. I just want to thank Janie, the Honorable Janie Blackwell, for coming up with this. This is very important for those that live in Philadelphia Housing Authority, that y'all all come together as a body to watch what the executive board members or anybody in housing do to the residents. So I just want to actually personally thank Janie for coming up with a resolution to help the residents. And also, I just want to ask, also thanks my councilman Curtis Jones for being in my corner about the housing, because I did have some problems with housing. I'm not going to go into the details about it, but I just think this is an outstanding revolution that Janie came up with, that y'all be the watcher for the safety of housing. That's it. Thank you.
There are no other speakers on the public comment list, Mr. President.
Thank you. That concludes our public comment session. At this time, we will move to our calendar on bills and resolutions. Mr. Decker, would you please read the title of Resolution 140214?
A resolution authorizing the Commissioner of Public Property to execute and deliver to the Philadelphia Redevelopment Authority without consideration deeds, conveying conditional fees, simple title to such city on lots of pieces of ground with the buildings and improvements thereon, situated in the 29th Ward of the City of Philadelphia.
Chair recognizes Councilman Kenny. Just move for adoption.
Oh, I'm sorry. Move for the adoption of the resolution.
Thank you. Been moved and properly second. All those in favor? Those opposed? Ayes have it. And the resolution is adopted. Mr. Decker, 140240.
A resolution authorizing the Commissioner of Public Property to execute and deliver to the Philadelphia Redevelopment Authority without consideration deeds, conveying conditional fees, simple title to such city on lots of pieces of ground with the buildings and improvements thereon, situated in the 47th Ward of the City of Philadelphia.
Chair again recognizes Council McKinney.
I move the adoption of the resolution.
Thank you. It's been moved and properly second. All those in favor? Those opposed? Ayes have it, and that resolution is adopted. Mr. Decker, 140241.
A resolution authorizing the Commissioner of Public Property to execute and deliver to the Philadelphia Redevelopment Authority without consideration deeds, conveying conditional fees, simple title to such city on lots of pieces of ground with the buildings and improvements thereon, situated in the 36th and 48th wards of the City of Philadelphia.
Chair recognizes Councilman Johnson.
The adoption of the resolution.
Second. It's been moved and properly second. All those in favor? Aye. Those opposed? Ayes have it, and resolution 140241 is adopted. Mr. Decker, 140243.
A resolution authorizing the Commissioner of Public Property to execute and deliver to the Philadelphia Redevelopment Authority without consideration deeds, conveying conditional fees, simple title to such city on lots of pieces of ground with the buildings and improvements around, situated in the 18th, 19th, 33rd, and 43rd wards of the City of Philadelphia.
Chair recognizes Councilwoman Keona Sanchez.
The adoption.
Second.
It's been moved and properly seconded. All those in favor? Those opposed? Ayes have it, and that resolution is adopted. Thank you. Mr. Decker, please read the title of 130-699-AA.
An ordinance amending Title 14 of the Philadelphia Code entitled Zoning and Planning by revising parking requirements for driveways located in residential front yards.
Chair recognizes Councilman O'Neill.
Thank you, Mr. President. I move that bill number 130-699-AA be withdrawn.
Thank you. It's been moved and properly seconded. That bill number 130-699-AA be withdrawn. All those in favor? Those opposed? Ayes have it. And bill number 130-699-AA is withdrawn. Mr. Decker, please read the title of 130-587.
An ordinance amending section 19201 of the Philadelphia Code entitled City Depositories by authorizing the city treasurer to deposit funds in U.S. Bank.
This bill has been read on two separate days. The question is, shall the bill pass finally? Mr. Decker, please call the roll.
Councilwoman Bass? Councilwoman Blackwell? Councilman Good? Councilman Greenlee is voting aye. Councilman Heenan? Councilman Johnson? Councilman Jones? Councilman Kenny? Councilman O'Brien? Councilman O'Neill? Councilman O? Councilwoman Carolina Sanchez? Councilwoman Reynolds Brown? Councilman Squilla? Councilwoman Tasco? Council President Clarke?
Aye. Ayes are 16, nays are 0. Majority of members present voting in the affirmative, the bill passes. Mr. Decker, 140-072.
An ordinance authorizing and approving the execution and delivery of a service agreement between the City of Philadelphia, between the City and the Philadelphia Municipal Authority relating to the financing of the acquisition from the Philadelphia Authority for Industrial Development of an approximately 15-acre tract of land in the city bounded by 46th Street, Market Street, Haverford Avenue, and 48th Street, together with the improvements thereon, and the making of certain capital improvements to such land and improvements, including the development of a new police department headquarters and related parking accommodations.
This bill has been read on two separate days. The question is, shall the bill pass finally? Mr. Decker, call the roll.
Councilwoman Bass? Councilwoman Blackwell? Councilman Good? Councilman Greenlee is voting aye. Councilman Heenan? Councilman Johnson? Councilman Jones? Councilman Kenny? Councilman O'Brien? Councilman O'Neill? Councilman O, Councilwoman Carolina Sanchez, Councilwoman Reynolds Brown, Councilman Squilla, Councilwoman Tasco, Council President Clarke.
Aye, the ayes are 16, the nays are 0. Majority of members present voting in the affirmative, the bill passes. Mr. Decker, 140-073.
An ordinance authorizing the Philadelphia Municipal Authority, incorporated pursuant to the Municipality Authorities Act, as amended from time to time, to undertake any project as defined in the Act that the authority is specifically authorized to undertake from time to time by ordinance of the City Council.
This bill has been read on two separate days. The question is, shall the bill pass finally? Mr. Decker, call the roll.
Councilwoman Bass? Councilwoman Blackwell? Councilman Good? Councilman Greenlee is voting aye. Councilman Heenan? Councilman Johnson? Councilman Jones? Councilman Kenny? Councilman O'Brien? Councilman O'Neill? Councilman O? Councilwoman Carolina Sanchez? Councilwoman Reynolds Brown? Councilman Squilla? Councilwoman Tasco? Council President Clarke?
Aye. The ayes are 16, the nays are 0. Majority of members present voting in the affirmative, the bill passes. Mr. Decker, 140-099.
An ordinance constituting the 17th supplemental ordinance to the restated general water and wastewater revenue bond ordinance of 1989 as supplemented, authorizing the bond committee to issue and sell one or more series or subseries of tax-exempt or taxable water and wastewater revenue bonds.
This bill has been read on two separate days. The question is, shall the bill pass finally? Mr. Decker, call the roll.
Councilwoman Bass? Councilwoman Blackwell? Councilman Good? Councilman Greenlee is voting aye. Councilman Heenan? Councilman Johnson? Councilman Jones, Councilman Kenny, Councilman O'Brien, Councilman O'Neill, Councilman O, Councilwoman Carolina Sanchez, Councilwoman Reynolds Brown, Councilman Squilla, Councilwoman Tasco, Council President Clarke.
Aye, the ayes are 16, the nays are 0. Majority of members present voting in the affirmative, the bill passes. Mr. Decker, do you have any additional resolutions?
A resolution honoring and recognizing the Honorable President Matthew Shore for his trailblazing efforts in the fields of higher education and osteopathic medicine and his leadership at Philadelphia College of Osteopathic Medicine on this occasion of his retirement. Introduced by Councilwoman Blackwell.
Chair recognizes Councilwoman Blackwell.
Thank you, Mr. President. I move for the adoption.
It's been moved and properly seconded. All those in favor? Those opposed, ayes have it, and that resolution is adopted.
And a resolution proclaiming the month of April as Financial Literacy Awareness Month in the City of Philadelphia, introduced by Councilwoman Blackwell.
Chair recognizes Councilwoman Blackwell.
Thank you, Mr. President. I move for the adoption.
It's been moved and properly seconded. All those in favor? Those opposed, ayes have it, and that resolution is adopted.
And a resolution congratulating Marlene Trice on receiving the Pennsylvania AARP Andrus Award for Community Service, introduced by Councilwoman Tasco.
Chair recognizes Councilwoman Tasco.
Mr. President, I move for the adoption of the resolution.
Been moved and properly seconded. All those in favor? Those opposed? Ayes have it. That resolution is adopted.
And a resolution honoring, recognizing, and commending Reverend Dr. Aline E. Waller and Mr. Tariq Kareem El Shabazz, Esquire, for their extraordinary performance in Jeff Stetson's production, The Meeting, introduced by Councilman Johnson.
Chair recognizes Councilman Johnson.
That bill is also sponsored by Councilman Curtis Jones. I move for the adoption of the resolution.
It's been moved and properly seconded. All those in favor? Those opposed? Ayes have it. That resolution is adopted.
And a resolution recognizing and honoring the Philadelphia Children's Alliance for their commitment to promoting healing and justice for victims of child sexual abuse in Philadelphia and declaring April 2014 to be Child Abuse Awareness and Prevention Month in the City of Philadelphia, introduced by Councilwoman Quinones Sanchez.
Chair recognizes Councilwoman Quinones Sanchez.
Thank you, Mr. President. I move for the adoption.
Thank you. It's been moved and properly seconded. All those in favor? Those opposed? Ayes have it. And that resolution is adopted.
And a resolution recognizing Deaf History Month in Philadelphia by honoring the valuable societal contributions by the hearing impaired and deaf community, introduced by Councilman O'Brien.
Chair recognizes Councilman O'Brien.
Thank you, Mr. President. I move for the adoption of the resolution.
Second.
Been moved and properly seconded. All those in favor? Those opposed? Ayes have it. And that resolution is adopted.
And a resolution recognizing April 2014 is Autism Awareness Month in honor of individuals living with autism, their families, and those working to improve the quality of life for the entire autism community, introduced by Councilman O'Brien.
Chair again recognizes Councilman O'Brien.
Thank you, Mr. President. I move for the adoption of the resolution.
Second.
It is moved properly seconded. All those in favor? Those opposed? Ayes have it. And that resolution is adopted.
And a resolution honoring the Newman Goretti High School Girls Varsity Basketball Team for winning the Philadelphia Catholic League Championship, the PIAA District 12 AA City Championship, and reaching the PIAA AA State Championship game while finishing the season with an overall record of 29-1, introduced by Councilman Squilla.
Chair recognizes Councilman Squilla.
Thank you, Mr. President. That's also co-sponsored by Councilman Kenny. I move for the adoption of the resolution.
Second.
It's been moved and properly seconded. All those in favor? Those opposed? Ayes have it. And that resolution is adopted.
There are no other resolutions on the final passage calendar, Mr. President.
Thank you very much. That concludes our calendar. Are there any speeches on the part of the minority? Chair recognizes Councilman O'Brien.
Thank you, Mr. President. It's with great sadness that I announce the passing of Trina Lucino. She and her husband, David, created Special People in the Northeast Spin. And she passed away, unfortunately, at 4 a.m. yesterday morning. And I would just like to read the posting from the website of Vision for Equality. Thank you for your patience. In loving memory of Trina Lucino, a message from Spin Incorporated. It is with great sadness that we share the heartbreaking news of the passing of Trina Lucino. Trina courageously fought a battle against cancer for the past 8 months. During this time, she lived each day with grace and dignity as she did each day and every day of her life. Trina, a special education teacher, met David at the Tarsdale School in Philadelphia, and the rest became history, the history that we know. I'm sorry, I'm having technical difficulties here. The history that we know and love at SPIN involved Trina's determination, hard work, creativity, and vision of hope and service to others. Trina was the heart and dynamic inspiration behind the development of SPIN programs, which received and continue to receive accolades, both locally and nationally. While Trina certainly devoted herself to her work at SPIN, her work at home, embraced the lives of her five children, Christopher, Jennifer, Jonathan, Rebecca, and Ryan, it was with great joy that she spent her brief years in retirement with her grandchildren, Ethan, Sophia, Aiden, and Kate. Trina was the quintessential grandma, quilting, baking, celebrating, and establishing wonderful and exciting traditions, which will live on in the hearts of family and friends. Trina was known for her philosophical sayings, "You bring the party, put on your big girl pants, and when life gives you lemons, make lemonade." As we embrace these words of wisdom from a woman who left us all too soon, let us take a piece of her with us every day, in work and with our families. Mr. President, with your permission, I would ask that all members of City Council rise for a moment of silence in recognition of her tremendous and enormous contributions to the intellectual disability community across the City of Philadelphia and the Great Commonwealth.
Thank you. Please rise. Thank you. Chair recognizes Councilwoman Reynolds Brown.
Remarks from the majority?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
I'm sorry.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, I rise with a heavy heart, bittersweet, and a sense of excitement. I'll share my remarks in the following way. Leadership is not limited to the chairman. Leaders exist at all levels in government. Not all managers are leaders. However, only the good ones are. And not all leaders are managers. I submit that leaders are made and not born. Leadership, in fact, is a mix of skills, attitude, will, and motivation. To become a leader, you must want it or work on it. It requires much effort to get there and to remain there. Thus has been the case for my chief of staff for 14 years and 3 months. Managing, on the other hand, is an assignment. A manager is not a leader. A manager who is not a leader manages by title only, not the case with my chief of staff. A leader manager inspires people, sets an example, and builds trust. That has been the case with my chief of staff. He has made things happen. He's been a mentor and a coach. He's respected and followed by his peers. He has embraced the clear purpose of our office, which is to serve others. He has been loyal in helping my team build common goals regardless of obstacles or temporary setbacks that we have endured. He has led my team to accomplish what they thought might be impossible, and he has done this through personality and not position. David is in every way what I call a possibility thinker. He has worked with my team and me, and when faced with a mountain, did not quit. He has learned with me over the past 14 years about how to turn crazy ideas about legislation into meaningful legislation that has become law. Small examples, the Children's Fund, the lead bill, and menu labeling. He has been a resourceful chief of staff, believing that where there is a will, there is a way, and has proceeded always in being judicious and even-handed in his approach when managing the demanding task of our office. And so, as we walk this plank, as we look, albeit for me reluctantly, towards this next exciting chapter of your career, David Ford, today you stand on a mountaintop. Behind you are all of those struggles and challenges you conquered over the last 14 years and 3 months. Behind you lie the meaningful opportunities you seized and executed always with a sense of excellence, including choosing to work with me. Before you lies a new horizon filled with exciting possibilities. Thank you for being what I demand, and that is a possibility thinker. Thank you for being a coach to our team. Thank you for turning every situation into a learning situation. Thank you for being an ally. Thank you for being generous with praise to staff, your peers, and me for a job well done. Today, you choose the next chapter of your life. You're looking to a new direction in your career, and you need to know I join the many in this chamber who appreciate you, David Ford. I would ask the members of this body, guests, friends, and those of us who like to play real hard after we work real hard, to join us on April 3rd at Tango, 1021 Art Street, 5 p.m. to 8 p.m., as we congratulate David and say goodbye 14 years in the making. Let's salute my Chief of Staff, David Ford.
Thank you, Councilwoman. You may also mention that he's a proud resident of the 5th Council District. Thank you. Chair recognizes Councilman Kenny.
Thank you, Mr. President. I'm sorry to change gears a little bit after these last two emotional speeches, but we just voted today on Bill number 140072, which I voted for, and we've had a lot of discussion both in the Council hearing and in the Capital Budget relative to the $250 million expenditure for this very worthwhile project, and Councilwoman Blackwell has worked very hard to make sure that this happened out at 4601, and I think it's very important that we do this. We've had increasing discussions in Council about what I believe the woeful plan to set aside additional monies for improvements to police stations and firehouses. The $250 million going to pay for the 4601 renovation is for police headquarters, and it's going to do a lot of good things for the police department. Getting our police commanders out of a very terrible situation at the Roundhouse, which is a mess, and providing some additional support for police investigation and other type of forensic work, which I think is very, very important. But $250 million for this project and the amount of money that's being recommended by the administration for firehouses and police stations where the foot soldiers work, I think is abominable. We have committed, and I know with your help, we will be able to get that number up to an appropriate number to see, to make sure that the men and women in our police and fire departments go to work every day without mold, without mice, without leaks, with cabinet doors on their kitchen cabinets, with furniture and with windows that shut and open in the winter and the summer, appropriate air conditioning, clean bathrooms, not rusted out fixtures. While I'm happy for the commanders, we'll have a new place to work. Our rank and file need new and improved places to work, and we've had a lot of discussion, and we've heard a lot in the media about Pope Francis lately, about some of the ways in which he's changing the Catholic Church, and he recently chastised two cardinals, one in Germany and one in the United States, for the construction of a very large and opulent places for them to live, while the parishioners were suffering in churches that are falling down and schools that are closing. It's not the exact corollary, but to me it rings somewhat true in comparing the two situations. We have let our police stations and firehouses go for many, many years, despite the complaints that this council has brought forward in a number of administrations. And I think that we need to commit ourselves publicly and on the record, as I am doing now, to make sure that we at least get the $40, $50, $60 million necessary to bring our rank and file places of work and places of rest at night at the firehouse up to speed, comparable to $250 million we're investing in a new police headquarters. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Councilman. Chair recognizes Councilman Jones.
Thank you, Mr. President. On Tuesday at 55th and Market Street, somewhere between the 3rd and the 4th Councilmatic District, an 80-year-old senior was abducted, transported to a bank where she was forced to withdraw $8,000 of her lifetime savings. We've often discussed the safety of seniors in this chamber. We've done good things like encourage utilities to create a Be Sure Before You Open the Door campaign to make sure home invasions, particularly aimed at our seniors, be curbed. But according to the Corporation for the Aging, of the tens of thousands of seniors, only 1 in 44 actually reports the crimes when they're victimized. Many of those crimes, as Councilwoman Tasco has pointed out, are crimes of financial opportunity through predatory lending. But it has become apparent that more and more cowards are seeking the most vulnerable of the population, children, and in the other end of the spectrum, elderly, to victimize. So I personally hope that the courts start paying a lot more attention to those individuals who take advantage of the most vulnerable population, the elderly, 80 years old, to start to do that. But there's two things that we all can do. One, we're urging more and more citizens of Philadelphia to come out and join Town Watch, to take a day out of the month to go out and do patrols. That doesn't mean jump on someone's back and stop them, but to be with cell phones, armed and ready to call and let people know what's going on, what is out of place in your neighborhood. The second thing, Mr. President, that we have to start doing is showing up in court when these individuals are apprehended. And I want to point out that the police department did their job, that within 24 hours they apprehended the man and the woman that did this. But too soon in a news cycle, we forget what happened and we're on to the next thing. But what we have to do is send the signal that my mother, your mother, our aunts and uncles are precious to us, and that when it comes time for the sentencing, we won't forget and we won't take it lightly, and that we will seek a long, prosperous life inside somebody's institution when you victimize our seniors. We have to start sending that signal now, because at the end of the day, as they are, as we are, they once were, and as they are, if we're lucky, we shall be. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Councilman. Well spoken. Chair recognizes Councilman Johnson.
Thank you, Mr. President. And I want to also just add a small follow-up to Councilman Jones' comments regarding the scamming of the 80-year-old senior citizen, and hopefully our good district attorney do the due diligence and make sure that the individuals and the culprits who participated in the scam are put beneath the jail. Mr. President and colleagues, today I am happy to have the opportunity to put forth another resolution that focuses on affordable housing in my district, specifically the Point Breeze area, approving a contract through the Redevelopment Authority, specifically with an organization which is dear to my heart, which is Habitat for Humanity. While I served in the City Year program under AmeriCorps, fresh out of college, I had the opportunity to manage a City Year team that built the Habitat for Humanity house in your district, Council President, off of 18th and Diamond, near the Church of the Advocate. And I've always been a strong supporter of this particular type of housing program, because it allowed an individual an opportunity to be a first-time home buyer, but more importantly, they have an opportunity to build their home through sweat equity. And so, as we focus on the issue of development here in the City of Philadelphia, specifically in the Second Councilmanic District, I want to make sure that every neighborhood in my district is a neighborhood of choice regardless of income and background. And so I want to make note of that, because it's a part of my overall housing development plan and goals for my district. I also would like to invite my colleagues to an event this evening where I will be honored by the Sons of Italy, Columbus Four Lodge, 1492 at Galdo's, located at 20th and Moyer Mensing at 5:30 this evening. I will be receiving the Andrew Farnese Humanitarian Award. Again, that's by the Sons of Italy, and so I'm quite sure we're going to have a good time this evening. I want to thank my colleague also from South Philadelphia, my good friend, Councilman Mark Squilla, for placing an ad on my behalf. I had no idea until my staff had brought that to my attention, and so I really appreciate it. But I invite all of you, if you're not doing anything, to come out and have a good time in the South Philadelphia part of the second council matter district. Thank you, Council President.
Thank you, sir. Congratulations. Chair recognizes Councilwoman Blackwell again.
Thank you, Mr. President. I only take a moment. Certainly, congratulations to Councilman Johnson. And we're proud of the work that we've all been able to do with Habitat Humanity over the years. Per Councilman Jones, we realize that a nation is judged by the way it treats its elderly, its young, and its homeless. And we had many calls about this issue that happened, and this poor woman who was taken advantage of. And so I agree with his solution for what we must do. The community saying we have to be watchful, we need to make sure it's kept clean, and we have to make sure that when we deal with corridor work and expansion, that we include this area. Finally, I'd like to say that when Jim Kenney talked to me initially about police and firehouses and said, why don't we take 50 million? Should we take 50 million from the 250 million for the firehouse, for the 4601 and the police station relocation, or should we talk about 50 million going forward? I said, okay, well, let's talk about 50 million going forward. And as those who were on the committee realized that the finance committee opted to not move on this financing until we could check what was needed and what we should do in the budget process. But certainly I support that, and we need to do something to make sure that those who are prepared to make the ultimate sacrifice for us, to make sure that they work in decent conditions. So I am totally supportive of us taking whatever it takes, whether it be, as he just said, $40, $50, or $60 million, whatever the price tag is, to make sure that we move forward during this budget cycle with regard to police and fire stations. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Councilwoman. Chair recognizes Councilwoman Tasco.
As I agree with Councilwoman Blackwell, I think we ought to find money during this budget process, through the capital project process, to begin financing the upgrade of our fire station and police station. So we have the opportunity to do that now. I want to join Councilman Curtis on the whole issue of senior citizens being defrauded. I think what we might do through his chairmanship as the Finance Committee and as a member of the Finance Committee, I'd like for us to take an approach with the local banking institutions to see if we could get their cashiers, the employees, to be vigilant when a senior citizen comes into a bank to ask for a large amount of cash, and to find some way, and I don't have that solution, but through a discussion I think we ought to have with the local banking institutions, see if we can kind of stop that when they come into the bank and ask for the money. I know if I go to a store that I normally don't shop and I use my debit card, I get a call from my credit union saying, did you make this purchase? So we've got to find ways to help seniors. Some of them are timid, some of them will fight, but you know, they're afraid and they don't have weapons. So I suggest Councilman Curtis we move in that fashion. Also, I'd like to report that on Saturday, April 5th, my state representative, Sherelle Parker, and her staff will hold a workshop on Hold On To Your Money Financial Checkup at the Finley Rec Center, which is at Horter and Mansfield, at 10 a.m. And those who are listening and anyone could come and join that discussion and learn about how to handle their money and protect themselves also. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Councilwoman. And to recognize Councilman Heenan.
Thank you, Council President. And, you know, I too just want to echo the same sentiments and concerns that other council members had just mentioned about the conditions of our police and fire. Now, I know it's repetitive in me speaking in addition to my colleagues, but, you know, it just, you can't stress enough the importance of good working conditions, you know, for those who are on the front lines when it comes to public safety and protecting, you know, every citizen of our city. You know, we, you know, I'm going to speak up for myself in the 15th Police District. It is one of the largest police districts in the city of Philadelphia. It has the, it is the most densely populated police district and the busiest police district in the city of Philadelphia. And the conditions are deplorable. Right, you know, we're talking about, you know, setting aside money or advocating for millions of dollars not to even bring us into 2014. We're talking about trying to bring our first responders up to code. And there are reports after reports pointing out and, you know, just bringing to view the conditions, you know, that our police and our fire are subject to. And, you know, we shouldn't stand for that. You know, we are severely underfunded for obvious reasons. You know, we are government, and, you know, we have experienced budget cuts over many, many years, and especially in most recent years, but decades. And the buildings are old. I mean, these facilities date back to early 1900s, or as we had heard earlier, at least into the 1930s and 40s. With Band-Aid fixes along the way. And I don't think that is responsible for us without, you know, trying to make them a first priority, as they are truly the first responders for our first protection. So, you know, I want to thank Councilwoman Blackwell for her years of dedication and commitment to making that possible. And you know, Councilman Kenny, you know, with the police and fire, he has never blinked. So I think together, you know, we can hopefully get some movement here in this budget process. So thank you.
Thank you, Councilman. And Councilman Kenny?
I hate to come back to the microphone just one more time, but I the discussion's over the 80-year-old woman who was taken advantage of. And Councilwoman Tasco hit the nail on the head. How do you hand over $8,000 to an 80-year-old person and let them walk out the door? And not be afraid or concerned that someone, even if it's not the two that's abducted her, but someone else that's watched her come in and go out, and to put $8,000 in an envelope and let her go on her way, that's irresponsible. I mean, I understand it's the person's money, but there should be some protocol, some checkoff, some something, questions that are required to be asked by the teller, even if the old person says, mind your own D business, you know, but something, because I got to believe that that woman had to be in a very paralyzed situation where she's afraid she's been abducted. Here's 8,000, here's 10,000, here's whatever, and go on the street. There's got to be an overall discussion with our banking industry of what we can do internally across the counter from that person, because a lot of these folks, they go into banks where the people know them, and if you know them, or if you know their circumstances, they don't usually leave the neighborhood. Downtown's a different situation, but in the neighborhood it's different. I got to believe there should be some protocols talked about that they should have to follow within the city limits of Philadelphia. Maybe we keep that from happening. So thanks for the additional time.
Thank you, Councilman. Chair recognizes Councilman Jones again.
Yeah. This natural reaction from this body doesn't surprise me, because we've been doing this for a minute. The key statistic is only 1 in 44 actually reported because of fear and shame. And one of the things that I want to point out to you is one other thing, that some of these things are setups, that some caregiver, some person involved in that person's life, saw a bank statement, got too much information, and then decided to turn that information into a target of opportunity, meaning them. So we have to do a wide range of things. I actually am meeting with PCA, Philadelphia Corporation for the Aging, right after this session, to talk about that. And I just heard some of my colleagues may want to join them with me to come up with some comprehensive legislation that safeguards our seniors. And it's just overwhelming to think, you know, that those are all of our mothers and aunts and fathers out there that are being targeted. So we're gonna take a look at this holistically from the banking institutions and to working with the district attorney's office, who has a prosecutor specifically assigned to crimes against seniors. And we're gonna come up with something.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Councilman. Count me in. With that, the chair recognizes Councilwoman Brown for a motion to adjourn.
Yes, Mr. President. There's an educational tenet that says repetition breeds learning. So to Councilman Heenan's remarks, I am going to be repetitive and underscore the concerns raised by members led by Councilman Jim Kenney with regards to firefighters. Yes, we need to figure that out, and we need to be strategic as we look at how we be of better service to those men and women who go on the front line. Secondly, I take care of an 86-year-old mom as her caregiver. And hearing this story really broke my heart, because there are too many like them who are in the twilight of their lives. So I believe, too, we really have a responsibility to sit down with the banking industry, Philadelphia Corporation of Aging, and figure out the protocols that need to be instituted so that we don't have to hear another story, which really is only one of how many? One of 40 that go reported. So yes, it's a signal for us that we as a council need to act on those two important matters. With that, I move that council stand adjourned until Thursday, April 10th, 2014 at 10 a.m. Thank you.
Thank you. It's moving probably second. The council stand adjourned until Thursday, April 10th, 2014, 10 a.m. All those in favor? Those opposed? Ayes have it. Thank you all very much.